Hello, welcome to Antonus TV. My name is Jack Duxbury, he's the Maltese Falcon. And that's us. And welcome to Get Your Rig Out. This is episode 2. We're in Guildford, we're in Anderton's. The first one was with Charlie from Bastille. Please go check that out. We're gonna do a few more of these. But weirdly and selfishly, this one's on me because I did a gig recently. I got lured out of retirement to play with That Pedal Show, the guys from That Pedal Show, Mick, Dan, and Andy Timmons, and we did a couple gigs. And in the following video, I'm gonna talk about the setup I used for it, a little bit about how I learned the songs, and go through the patches of this set list. Here, Falcon, is that acceptable? Oh, the Falcon can make it work. Let's get into it. You saw the set list briefly, right? So we're talking pretty classic tunes. Like the posher side of Wedding Band, right? But there's a lot of sounds in there I had to nail. And luckily, my old faithfuls, this Nord Stage 3 88 and this Nord Electro 5D, this is the 73 key version, get me through it. And they got me through it. Ideally, I would, to cover some of the parts, especially on tunes like Rosanna and things like that, I think you need more keyboards or more keyboard players. And that's what I'm gonna talk about in the following video as well. A lot of the compromises I made in each song. So we've got the 88 key stage 3 here, mainly using this for piano and synth as you'll hear. And this mainly I leave for organ or auxiliary sounds. Let's just jump in. The first tune that we had to play, the set list went That Pedal Show Band, then Andy Timmons. So let's go in order. The first one on the set was Shine On You Crazy Diamond. So the challenges on this one for me were the intro. So let's have a listen to the intro. That's enough, because if you know that song, that goes on for 13 minutes, right? And I'd forgotten that, I'd heard it. I'm not the biggest Pink Floyd guy, sadly, but I'm gonna tell you how I thought about it. First things first, I went to the Nord Stage 3 because that bit at the beginning is such a signature sound. I tried programming it, I failed over and over. It's something about that drone that's going. So the compromise was looping a little bit of the actual recording, and I put it onto this octave here on the keyboard. And then you'll see as well, I had a limited time to do this, so I'm gonna show you warts and all, what all the compromises were. I get that I could assign this to a volume thing, but I just swelled it in on the volume knob. Gangster. And then I could pin it down with my foot. And I put a really long release time on here, on this sample layer. So it just says Shine On, sample 255. And that's what I love about the Nord. I could just adjust the release. I'll show you without it. If I shorten that release. Yeah. So I'll spend time thinking. And a little bit like cooking. You know, you gotta find something that works. And also why I like the Nord is that when I get in the room, this is the whole thing that I wanna talk to you about. Your expectations going into a gig as a keyboard player. So I had that sound down and I'm like, oh, I'm gonna have to nail the synth bit at the beginning. So I put a synth here in the right hand. I thought, oh God, I'm gonna do some some shredding at the beginning. I made the decision, I thought, there's so much, I can't be bothered to learn all of that note for note. I thought that will buy me the authenticity from the crowd. Oh, they can hear that, Shine On You Crazy Diamond, can't be bothered to learn it note for note what he's playing on the synth, so I'll create a patch. And on this patch, you can hear a lot going on, and that's why I love the Nord 2. So this is a separate section here, and we can see what we're going on. We've got two detuned saw waves. I've got a little bit of drive on the filter, which gives it, I thought, oh, this will poke through. And this worked out all right, but I made this posh sound so I could be like. And I had visions of fading out and being like. And the aftertouch is bringing in that stereo delay and reverb. Got to the rehearsal and Dan was like, yeah, we're not gonna do any synth bit at the beginning, I'm gonna play. And you're like, oh, okay. So I sacked that off. Just so you know, that's the decisions, right? So that's the intro. Dan's shredding, and then they wanted to go straight into the verse. It's a huge arrangement, but then up here, I've just got, which is just this drawbar. And a little tip on organ sounds, make them thinner, and then you've got a chance, especially if you've got drawbar control, whatever keyboard you got, you can, when you get to the gig, pull them out if you're feeling lost or the monitoring's not very good. But this one, I've just got the third drawbar, which is that, it's a bit muddy if it's like this. I was prepared to go in. I knew there was a bass player, two guitar players and a drummer. It's gonna be really loud. I wanna be in between the guitar and the bass. So on this one, I just had that. And I'm working the rotary. And then when I got to the Shine On You bit, doing a lot of this, quite a lot of reverb on there. I wouldn't normally have that much reverb, but again, I wanted to just sit around the guitar. And you see, I'm working this. I'm working a volume pedal. And I've only got one sustain and one volume, and that's because the Nord, the external, you can do it on loads of keyboards, but they make it so easy on the Nord. Got the external section here. I have that turned on every patch. And what that allows me to do is send messages to this keyboard, but not note data. So I'm not triggering, got those different sounds, but this information is going through. And I can select that here with a shift and a press. I could take the control pedal off. See, it's not working, shift control pedal. So very simple, that's what's happening. And also you'll see that when I change patch onto song two, because that's Shine On You Crazy Diamond, each patch I've MIDI'd up to send to the corresponding patch on the top keyboard. And what's nice is if I change set list or I wanted to change them around, I only change it on here. And then that means it's always pointing to that patch. You can just change the order, it'll always point to the right one there. And I've learned to, it's worth making the effort to do that, because there's nothing worse than thinking you've changed patch on both and then steaming in with the wrong patch, all right? And on this gig, because it's about guitars, it's about people turning up to see guitar sounds, I just wanted to kind of nail bits on the record enough, but stay out of the way. So on message in the bottom, instead of playing through the whole thing, it just gets to, I'll send an S. And if you listen on the record, there's some Hammond, okay? And I'm just holding that. Let's demo it, baby. Easy peasy. So it's just an A and an E with a couple drawbars out, and sometimes I would But other than that, I stayed out of the song. So that's a simple one. Hear My Trainer Coming. This was Mick showing off his new 12-string electric, and it's a Dore Bramall song. And again, talking about expectations in rehearsal towards the gig, I just didn't want to go in there unprepared. So at the beginning, you'll hear all this nonsense. It's the sound of Lee opening his wallet. Right, so weird stuff going on. And it turned out to be a lifesaver because tuning an electric 12-string was disastrous. And luckily, all the people there were so... It's such a beautiful gig, all the guys that turned up there, because it was like a train spotting convention. We all like pedals and we're all there to support Mick and Dan. So whilst he's tuning up, I had this sound, right? So check this out. So I didn't go crazy after the record on it, but I wanted that ambience, and luckily it turned out all right. What's going on there? So I've got a glockenspiel sample on here, mixed with a triangle wave, and the sample and hold LFO is doing some weird stuff. That's where I'm getting that gurgling from. Other than that, I've just got ring mod and vibe on there, and lots of reverb. So check this, what I was doing with the ring mod, and that's where I got more bell-like overtones. I couldn't really get it out of that sample. So I cranked the ring mod. And luckily, he was tuning for ages, so I could kind of keep that ambience, and I snuck in a little bit of organ. And he's playing along. The organ just gave it a bit of a tonality. Go on, Mickey. What I'm doing there is showing you exactly why I start off with less drawbars. And I often, as a habit, when I change patch, make sure they're reset. So I can see on this screen that just the bottom drawbar is in the preset. No one's gonna get cross at that. The other thing I might do when the drummers, I'll tap the delay. Because I just wanna give it a bit of psychedelic stuff going on there. And when he came in on the swell, I was like, ah, it comes on the G. I didn't have enough, so I And then when it got to the verse, I'm always just thinking, is this supposed to be more exciting? If it's more exciting, I will pull out more drawbars to the right. And you can see that I'm riding that on my foot. And that's one thing that if you can plug a volume pedal into your organ, it really just makes things live a bit better and just feel nice, especially when you're recording. With like all the classic records, those guys were rinsing the volume pedal and just go with your gut. You know, there's no right or wrong on it. Next one, Owner of a Lonely Heart. Come on.
Here we go.
This is where the fireworks come in. Well, actually, this shows you as well, I forgot to do Peg. So Peg is a bit on here, Peg's next. And I was like, oh, Peg. Because I've done this a few times before and it's just a lot of work figuring out the chords. But let's have a listen to the intro. So what I hear there is clav and Rhodes, and I hear flanger. Check it again. I hear like a flanged out Rhodes and a clav. So I tried doing that on this. That's what I got to. So I've got exactly that. I've got two panels on the Nord, so a layer on whatever keyboard you've got. And if I turn that off, this is what the Rhodes sounds like on its own. So that's where I'm getting the flange. And check it out. It's only coming through that speaker. And that's like a little trick on the Nord. If you put auto pan on and max out, I'll show you. So auto pan, you can use it as a pan control. If you max out the amount, it will stay over there. If I go the other way around, there we go. Both down, it stays in that speaker. And I just learnt that by accident, which allows me to pan things. So if that makes sense, yeah. To be in that speaker, I've got the rate and the amount down. To be in the other speaker, just crank the amount. And that allowed me to layer the two and have them in each side. So check out, this is the clav on the other side. And then together. And I felt, if I take those off, which I had to on the first night because I only had mono outputs. Ta-da! Which is cool. And I got no problem being mono, and I can get that can be a bit silly. But when I had two guitar players, I thought it sounded better with at least something coming out of different speakers instead of it just being a wall of something down the middle. So that's a little bit of panning on Peg. I bottled out of doing the in the verse, you know. I got Dan to do that bit, so I didn't have to bother doing that, which was great. So on to the next one, Owner of a Lonely Heart. Jeez Louise. This is what I got for the intro. Which was an easy win because you can just sample the intro. Here's the record. And then all I did was play that. I gave Mick a count. 1, 2, 3, 4. And he came in with the guitars. And the next challenge in this song, if you know the song, if not, is the. And in the verse, there's a kapow. We've also in the chorus when it, oh no, I'm a lonely heart. I'm just. Riding the filter on that until I get to the. I'm gonna do a bit of a play along because it's an example, I think a good example of what I like to do on gigs, which is stay out of it. A lot of the time I see keyboard players trying to just fill the gap, especially when there's two guitar players. So on this, you'll see that I'm just trying to pick out the bits that they can't play. So check it out. I'll miss out the intro. I'll see if I can get the intro. Absolute banger. Coming up. Doing nothing, there's nothing to play here. I've got a little hit coming up. Just want to be doing something. Open up the filter on this bit. So you get an idea of what I was doing there. The only other bit was the middle bit. If you know the song, I broke up. I was thinking, those drum fills are so iconic from the record. So I went in with an idea of an arrangement as well in my mental little head. I thought, I bet the drummer's gonna try to play it, but if I get the samples right, I can just play it. So check this out. And then it starts the solo. So all it was going in there and saying, oh, I'm really sorry, mate. I've come up with this crazy thing. You can hear that. That's one of the dangers of split. Luckily, I didn't do that on the gig. But there's a really great, you can actually soften and fade the splits. So it's not as drastic. One of the nice features on the Nord. Let's keep burning through it. That's under of a Lonely Heart. Also, I just want to talk about the mixer down here and the reason why I've got this plugged in. Normally in here for the Falcon we just record everything separate, but I wanted to talk about learning the songs as well, and you can see how handy it is to have a mixer to combine the signals. Normally I put my headphones in because I didn't know whether it would be in-ear monitors or real monitors, so I can check the patches through some speakers if I've got them, and also with some headphones. Makes it really easy. The other good thing is that I can balance the volume of what I'm working to and I can play along to it. I'll show you on the next one a little thing that happens with tunes as well. But a really big thing that is useful for having a mixer or it plugged in to something where you can read the levels that is arbitrary and not just your ears. One of the biggest problems I find with people and myself was turning up to gigs where people said, oh, your patches are all over the place. Have you had it on? Oh, yeah. You've been doing monitors, right?
Yeah, it's definitely. Well, the same thing, using a mixer to sum it all down.
Yeah, but mainly like between patches as well. So on this one, because I knew it was going to be quite agricultural in terms of where the venues were, literally in Froome and in Fat Lil's in Oxford, and they were awesome places, but I still would use a mixer and basically just make sure you've got something you can read the levels. And one tip is to make sure every patch is coming out at the same level, regardless of the perception of volume. And I've often found that sound guys enjoy that more, especially if I had a monitor guy. If I've got a monitor guy and all my patches are coming out at the same volume, then they can control the volume. And if we're doing scenes, if you're in a church or something like that, just it's really handy to have a small mixer. Just buy something with some levels on, because that's how you balance. Sometimes people have asked me, how do you balance volume between patches? Don't guess, because your ears will get it wrong. get a meter and do that. Anyway, on to the next one. You'll hear one of the problems of learning records from records, and this is a classic. Check this one out. Cool, right? So already there I can hear. And another big power tip is go through the set list. Before I started this, I went through, listened to the beginnings of all the songs, and I made a note of the ones that started with piano and or something that's keyboardy, and I prioritized those first because people are going to hear if I haven't done the work. That's a really quick one. If you're in a band, you've got to learn songs quickly. Learn the ones where you start. If everyone did that in a band, if the drummer learnt the songs which started with the drums, gigs would be way better. So that's one tip. Just listen for, do you start the song or not? So on this one, I can hear it, right? So, really simple. I can take one hit from the record and then put it in the sample editor. And you can't hear it though, but that is slightly pitchy. And then it goes. Now I couldn't get the exact Fairlight patch from it, which kind of bummed me out because I went on a bit of a search. Nord say they've got all the Fairlight samples, but they didn't have this. Check out that. I had to go for an R. That's what I went for. I'm holding it, and then. So check this out and listen to the problem. You'll hear it.
Oh, baby.
Oh, my keyboard's out of tune. No, it's not. It's that classic one, I'm learning a record that is out of tune. But you just got to pick a key. This is really in between. So I didn't even bother. I just plowed on and tried to learn the arrangement. But this is the sound I had for the synth. And this was one where it worked out exactly how I wanted. This is what I rehearsed and, or I hoped for, not what I wanted. When I went into the rehearsal, it turned out to be, because I was thinking, bass player is gonna do the dum, dum, dum. I'm not even gonna bother programming synth bass because I can't play that tight either. So the bass player was doing the dum, 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 dum. And on here, I've just got two sounds. I've got, on this panel, obviously I've split up the sample up here. And then on this one, I've got a warm brass preset. Which is perfect. This is just shift and list here, and it's warm brass. Bang on, some of the brass sounds are, the synthy brass sounds I love in here. I just thought, it sounds a lot more on the record and a bit more poke. A bit of a front end on it, so I found this sample. Really crappy. It's called Digi Grand One on here. These, and then that together without. It just gave me that hit, especially because we were gigging live and it worked out. Just the right, thankfully. Next one, oh geez Louise, let's hit it. Oh! Right, I'm not gonna play you all this. I'm gonna tell you the challenges that you face in Rosanna. And it's a bit, again, when I saw this on the set list, I'm like, oh crap, it reminds me of this video. If the Falcon can find it, a video of Greg Fillinganes that showing his setup and how he plays Rosanna.
So here's what's happening. As you can see, I have the four keyboard rig that I designed. And
in the song, there's organ, there's piano, there's horns. And they happen at different times. Sometimes they happen at the same time. You know. So now I'm in the chorus. And then the last bit of it is I throw the organ back up. Not to mention the little solo I have.
Whenever you mention that, everyone seems to have seen that video and they go, oh, what, like the Greg Finnegan's video of Rosanna? And you're like, yeah, yes, yes. Where he's got like six keyboards and he's Greg Finnegan's. There's a lot going on here piano-wise, so I'll break it down. You're never going to win on this one without two keyboard players. So it's about compromise, Rosanna, for me. Where did I start the compromise? First one is finding space for all the sounds. So we've got to do the piano, we've got to do the synth solo, which has multiple sounds in it. We also have to play the brass, which is something I freaking hate to do. I mean, just hire brass players, because I hate keyboard brass, but on this one I thought, oh, I've got to do it, just got to do it for the lads. So I sucked it up, got some brass on there, and a bit of organ. So we've got everything spread out here. First compromise is in that intro. Is this. Right? What I found was, this is the original patch I made in rehearsal. I already knew that I probably wouldn't go down there. Because it just gets really muddy. And I knew it wasn't going to work out that way. So I had it here. What I found is on the gigs, I wanted it to cut a bit more. And the gnaw is awesome for that, because I can just hit this timbre thing and it becomes a bright piano. Already, now, why didn't I think of that before? But what was great is on the gig, I went, oh, I'm being swallowed up here. Oh, bright. And then it goes. And this, I get it. Freaking out. You know, they sound so lame. And I think some people get caught up, this is a very personal opinion, you're never gonna win. You just don't even bother trying to get realistic brass sounds because they don't sound realistic. I know everyone's gonna be like, yeah, but on my Tyros, on my Korg, I use a laptop to get realistic horn sounds. In the heat of battle, these sounded great, especially with two. I just wanted something that was really pokey and sounded like an ensemble, right? So I hit that and I go to the F. And by now, I've just sacked off my left hand. Because the bass is doing it. And this was where I had to make a bit of a jump. It's rocking here. Now, you're seeing the benefit of one sustain pedal sustaining two things. I can get it so much smoother. I couldn't, let's turn that off and I'll prove it. I can't, even if I really try, check it out. I don't normally do this. It's nowhere near as smooth. Crikey, I've just given away the secret. It makes it all so perfect. So it's well worth getting one sustain pedal controlling both keyboards, in my opinion. And then we've got to do the hits. Sound all right? Notice I got a bit of reverb on there to pimp it out a bit. You can't do much with the samples in here, but I think I've got a little bit of dynamics on it. So I could at least do that. Then I've got to... Now you can hear something down here, check it out. And that's an example. You see this amber light here? I've got that soft fade. And it's a compromise I wanted to make because when I get to the solo on this bit, I also need to end it going like this. So being able to fade the cross points in the Nord, it just, all for me, you can say, I'm pretty about just wanting to make it neat, the transitions, almost like footwork in sport. That's the thing on pop keyboard playing or playing these parts of a record, we're trying to make it smooth, right? So that little crossfade, even though in isolation, you're like, oh, what's that? It really helped me on the gig. All right, and then I get to the solo. So I had to go. And then there's another sound that comes in, which is a completely different flute sound. Could not be bothered. So what I thought I could do is, oh, I can at least slap some delay on it because I can hear there's delay on it. Let's have a listen to the solo. So I'm like, oh, Jesus. Because again, the video, and I get it, everyone wants it, but I thought, this is one where, Jack, compromise. So I'm gonna show you where I compromised. You can already hear it. Well, that first bit, I think's all right. So I got to there, I'm like, oh, that's cool. That's just soft brass preset in there. Oh, when? Didn't even have to make it. There's a few I had to choose from. Check this out, soft brass, thin brass. Nah. Smooth. I kind of dig it. I went for soft brass, which on the gig was a problem because it didn't cut as well. But as soon as I got pokey, it didn't sound right. So I just asked the sound guy, when I wave wildly, like in Team America, like the secret signal, crank me up, mate. And so I just had a check. Sometimes if you feel like you're not got the level in your keyboards, because I didn't want to be running hot and half on the master, just talk to the sound guy. I said, mate, just on this one. And I made sure each night that he gave me a boost in the solo. And I get to that next bit, which is kind of like a change of sound with the delay. So I just went. That was my compromise. And then all I've got here is. And you can hear that I put the delay on this wheel, right? I get up to that bit, and then I've got to do the meow, 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 meow. Oh, Jesus Christ. So I just kept the same sound and went. So I'm just playing, maybe if you want me to break down any of these songs and actually teach you the notes, let us know in the comments. And we might do it again, whilst I still know these things. You can hear that crossfade, right? In there. And at the end, I crank that so I can do. Actually, I've got to go on the F. Because check it out. I'll play along with the compromise.
Me too, all the way. Me
delay in the crossfade lets me get in there, and it worked out really well on the night. That is Rosanna. Christ. Drowning my own tears, this was an executive decision.
It brings a tear into my eyes.
Already I'm thinking, how are we gonna compromise? Because we're a bunch of guys from England with no horns, and so I didn't even bother. And also I've got this thing, exposed piano, that type of thing, I don't even risk a lot of the time. In the processed piano sounds, I think work really well. So this, I just made an executive decision to go organ straight away, because
it brings a
all those plinky things in a venue, like if you're a local venue, they sound terrible. It doesn't matter, even if you've got a posh keyboard like this, piano sounds ball bags through big speakers. So I went organ, right?
It brings a tear to my...
And this is where the swell really helps, right? Because you can just... It's really a hard one to pull off an ensemble, so it's nice when you've got this. You can push people to the choruses and, along with the drawbars, show people which part of the song. So we get to that second bit. So I've got the reverb dimed. And then up the diminish. So I'm swelling each one. Hide my mistakes. And then when it gets the next bit, and that's the benefit of having drawbars, I'm gonna do all that. High and dry, executive decision. There's no piano on it, so I didn't play any no piano. Because check out how lame it sounds otherwise. What a song. It sounds good because there is no piano. If I chime in. Oh yeah. See, I mean, it just gets like primary school remix. So I stayed out of it. And sometimes that battle, because everyone goes, oh no, Jack, it sounds good if you play in it. And you're like, no, it doesn't. And you stick to your guns, stay out of it. Life in the fast lane. How was that? And whenever I gigged this, I just shredded organ on it. I would have been I would have done that, but it was the first time I heard the clav and how important it was, and it worked out really well. So check it out, I'll play along. What a banger. And all I'm doing there, and I was just trying to bind the two guitars together, and it worked out really well. I'm just hitting those bits. When it gets to the life in the fast lane, I just played the organ. That's that one. All Along the Watchtower, again, check it out. It's good because there's no piano, so I didn't play no piano on it. Same with The Boys Are Back in Town. What am I gonna do? I ain't gonna do that. But there was one song left on the set list. Come on, lads. Makes you proud to be British. Black lights, stop right. Now, yeah. Come on, man. What a tune. That was the first song I ever learned on bass when I was a kid. I was like, oh, I wanted that bass. And I never thought of the organ in there when I was a kid, but the organ's so dirty that it binds with the guitar. So this is what I've got. Dun, 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 dun. then when it got to the verse, the power of the Lord. Lord, he was just all about the fourths and fifths. Again, instead of being like, I mean, what? As soon as you start putting harmony in, you sound lame. So you just gotta eat shit and play along. Rocking. Black knights, stop riots, all feel so right. Don't care, sit tight, maybe a fight on the way down the line that I'm free. Free me. Let the guitar do his thing. And then when it gets to the solo bit, all I had was more drive, turn on a delay, and I would tap it. Yeah, so he's... And then I could turn that... And just mayhem, all the drawbars out, all this stuff. And when you end songs, here's a free tip. I did a video many moons ago on Hammond things to do about palm glissandos. That's the tip, right? Instead of going like this, you see dudes going like this? Nah, 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 nah. We want to get our palms on it and create stuff. So at the end, like, dun, 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 dun. You can do all that stuff. When your palms, it's so much smoother. Scrap the dishes. Right, that was the cover set. I'm gonna play us out. Thank you, Falcon. Thank you, Oz, for there. We've got an exciting few more get your rig outs planned.
Oh yeah.
Absurd things. People letting me out into the wild, and also some people coming to Guildford that are blowing my mind. And if you like this, we'll keep it going. And we'll be out in the wild on those ones. I had the honour of playing with Andy Timmons, who was a childhood hero of mine. ACM around the corner. Me and my mate Ross, we used to rinse. And Ricky Iyer, we used to watch loads of Andy Timmons, along with like Scott Henderson, Frank Gambale, you know, that era, VHS kings. And he came over and played with that pedal show. I'm going to play us out on one called EWF, which I thought was just a dope tune. On this one, again, listen, I'm trying to be that less is best. Let's not say less is more. It's just better sometimes. So I'm trying to just play what's on the record and you'll hear what's going on. On this one here, organ, and I compromised with the Rhodes. So this bit of a shh. Yo, Froome! You freaking ready? I ain't doing. Apart from this hit. Fifths again, John Lord. So what I'm doing there is compromising. So on the chorus, because I can't play the full voicings, so I'm trying to cop two keyboard players there. And again, something about being on the volume pedal without that just doesn't sound as posh. And then No point for the chords, because he's doing all that. And then... always. I'll carry on playing. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks, Falx. Thanks, Oz. Hey. Trying to stay out of his way here.